Jeff Marinoff, rail fan and transit historian, began taking movies of Philadelphia trolleys when he was in his mid-20s. This presentation features Jeff's commentary on his films, as well as former SEPTA motorman Richard Vible and other filmmakers' movies. We start Philadelphia Trolleys 2 with a brief look at some of the trolley lines that operated in the 1960s and 70s, starting with those that ran from the 40th Street portal to Southwest Philadelphia. This was one of the two portals where the cars emerged from the streetcar subway. The other was at 36th Street and handled the Route 10 line. The 40th Street portal was opened in November of 1955. It was an extension from 30th Street that was built to relieve traffic congestion around the University of Pennsylvania campus. From the main subway, the branch followed 36th Street with a stop at Sansome. Continuing under Woodland Avenue to 37th Street Station, the cars emerged from the portal. From there, they crossed 40th Street to a boarding area, and then they curved to their respective routings. This PCC was the only one to be painted in the PTC bus livery, complete with a white roof. In its original configuration, errant motorists would mistakenly turn onto the subway ramp. After attempts of posting "Do Not Enter" signs failed, spikes and trenches were installed to prevent entry. The problem was eventually solved when the street was closed. Today's LRV operators have no worries of motorists driving into the subway. The Route 34 car emerges from the portal and veers to its right to pick up a passenger for its trip to 61st Street. Jeff Marinoff comments.
Route 34 was a subway surface car line, and still is today, that operates from 61st and Baltimore Avenue, down Baltimore Avenue, through the surface car subway, down to City Hall in Center City, Philadelphia.
Originally, two-man PCCs ran on the route. The cars were pay-as-you-leave outbound. The conductor's station was by the rear doors, and riders could only exit by the center doors. The inbound cars were pay-as-you-enter.
Cars on Baltimore Avenue cross 42nd Street, which still has trolley tracks today, used for barn pull-ins and pull-outs, and also for emergency routing and diversions. It's today operated with the Kawasaki trolleys.
Thank you.
Route 13 operated between the Yadin Loop in Yadin, Delaware County, and City Hall in Center City, Philadelphia, via Chester Avenue and the surface car subway. There was also a shuttle line that operated from that same loop to the Darby Loop, known as the Route 62 trolley. This is a Route 62 car approaching Yadin Loop coming from Darby. And that is a Route 62 car leaving Yadin Loop, returning to the Darby Loop, where it connected with a Route 11 trolley. This was a very short piece of one block long private right-of-way coming out of Darby Terminal on Route 62, heading towards Yadin. Route 62 was and still is, even though it's not designated as a route today, a very circuitous, interesting line. Route 11 operates between Darby in Delaware County, Pennsylvania, and Center City, Philadelphia, City Hall via the surface car subway. Here we see the Darby Loop at 11th and Main Street in Darby, and it's also shared with the Route 62 trolley. At the time of these movies, Route 36 was a shortened version of the Route 37 Chester Short Line. It was only operating to the loop at 94th and Eastwick Avenue in the Eastwick section of Philadelphia. Prior to that, it operated to the Westinghouse Electric Plant in Leicester and actually used PTC cars in that operation. And prior to that, used double-end equipment all the way to Chester when it was known as the Route 37 trolley. Here it's shown taking the loop at 94th Street. And due to the low ridership and the very poor condition of the track in that area, it was cut back to 88th Street and Eastwick Avenue, approximately 1962. Island Road was private right-of-way operation. The track was in terrible condition and has since been completely rebuilt and upgraded to high standards for the light rail cars that now operate there. The car is seen at Elmwood Avenue and Island Road, which is now the site of SEPTA's Elmwood District, which is a new car house and maintenance facility for the light rail vehicles. Route 10 was a subway surface car line that operated from City Hall all the way out to the 36th Street portal and then to 63rd Street and Malvern Avenue. This car is turning from 63rd Street onto Malvern Avenue, and it will be entering the 63rd and Malvern Loop, which was located at the city line of the City of Philadelphia. The line never was extended any further than that point.
Route 10's Malvern Loop was shared originally with the Route 41 feeder cars. Both routes could lay over in the loop because of the track configuration. The same looping remains today, even though Route 41 is long gone. Amateur filmmakers sometimes use their movie cameras to study an operation. On this occasion, the late Ivor Walsh shot many angles of the cars entering the loop, which 40 years later I have edited so as to make it look as if there are many movie cameras involved in the sequence, when in fact there was only one.
Route 15 operated in Philadelphia between the Richmond and Westmoreland Loop, down Richmond Street to Girard Avenue, and over Girard Avenue all the way to 63rd Street in West Philadelphia. This scene shows the car going around the Richmond and Westmoreland Loop. The car is now coming out of the loop and making a right turn to Richmond Street. Car is now approaching Richmond and Allegheny, and on your left is the old car barn that used to sit at the corner of Richmond and Allegheny. During the construction of I-95, the trolleys were diverted for a period of approximately 6 months while the bridge was built and the I-95 itself was built. And this car is turning off of Richmond onto Norris Street, which no longer exists today. And it will enter the construction area for the I-95 work. That work was done so that the streetcars could continue to operate during the period of construction. And the trolleys are now actually on a bridge overhead. They do not run on the surface in that area now. Quite extensive, considering that it was almost a project that could have caused the line to be temporarily bust, but at the time it was not. Interesting to note that this line is being rebuilt today by SEPTA to light rail standards using rebuilt PCC cars, and it will soon go back into service. You'll notice the safety islands for the trolleys were removed when trolley service was temporarily suspended, and in the project to rebuild Girard Avenue, SEPTA has actually replaced the trolley islands with brand new islands. This was a temporary shoe fly crossover put in for a construction site over a railroad bridge on the west end of the Route 15 trolley line on Girard Avenue. Signal used for the single track operation in that construction work zone. Route 60 operated on Allegheny Avenue from Richmond and Westmoreland Loop, which is shown here, which was shared with Route 15, all the way to 35th and Allegheny on the western end of the city. This car is leaving Richmond and Westmoreland Loop, turning onto Richmond Street. It will proceed on Richmond to Allegheny and then make a right turn on Allegheny Avenue to go westbound. This is Allegheny Avenue approaching Richmond Street, and in the scene you can see the crossovers, which are reminiscent of the days when double N cars were used on the line. This was the safety car in Philadelphia. It was one trolley that PTC painted up with safety slogans for the Green Cross for Safety campaign. Originally the car was all white, but they painted the front green below the windshield to make it more recognizable as a trolley to passengers. This car is approaching the elevated station at Kensington and Allegheny. The photographer is standing on the elevated platform looking down on Allegheny Avenue. Again, you can see the crossovers that are from the days when the line operated double-end 5200-type cars. That is the elevated station at Kensington and Allegheny. And that car is proceeding westbound on Allegheny Avenue, heading towards 35th Street.
This car was part of an order of PCCs delivered in February 1941 that ran on Route 40. It was already beginning to show its age.
Route 53 operated on a line from Wayne and Carpenter Lane in Germantown to the 10th and Luzerne car barn. It was a very, very scenic, picturesque line on Wayne Avenue. And this car is on a fan trip, and it is shown entering the Wayne and Carpenter Lane loop, which was very unique because the loop had a house built in the middle of it. We often joked about the fact that we hoped that the people that lived in that house were trolley fans. Wayne Avenue was probably, if not the, it was one of the most scenic lines in Philadelphia. This also was the first line in the city of Philadelphia where PCC cars were operated in 1938. And this is on 10th Street, making a left onto Luzerne Street, where it will enter its own trolley loop on the property of the 10th and Luzerne car barn. Building in the background is Little Flower High School, which was a girls-only high school. Car now enters 10th Street on its return trip to Wayne and Carpenter Lane.
Car 2054 was stored for a number of years at Callow Hill Car House. During Trolley Fest 95, the public had an opportunity to see and ride the car at Elmwood District.
At the time these movies were taken, Route 6 was a shortened version that operated from the Broad and Olney subway terminal to City Line via Ogontz Avenue. Originally, it was the Willow Grove trolley, a line that I loved when I was a child and loved to ride. It was probably my all-time favorite trolley line in the city of Philadelphia, where I grew up. These scenes are shown on Champlo Street. And this is on the short piece of Old York Road approaching Nedro Avenue, where the car will make a left on Nedro and then down to Park Avenue and into the Broad and Olney Terminal. This was a place in Philadelphia where trolleys actually operated on Broad Street. There were only two places in the city where that happened, and Route 6 was one of them.
This portion of track on Broad Street was unique in that automobile traffic could pass the trolley, and also the trolley ran beside parked automobiles.
SEPTA purchased the Philadelphia Transportation Company, and they had a ceremony to honor the event. Here we see, on the left, the president of Philadelphia Transportation Company, Robert Steer. In the center was Philadelphia's mayor, James H.J. Tate, and on the right, the chairman of the board of SEPTA, James McConnon. And the ceremonial key was passed from PTC to SEPTA. President Steer gave a speech, James McConnon gave his speech, and then the Honorable James H.J. Tate, the mayor of Philadelphia, spoke. That was a temporary sticker, or decal, placed over the PTC decal, showing that it was now SEPTA. Then the party, after the ceremony, boarded a bus back down to Center City, Philadelphia, to the Bellevue Stratford Hotel on Broad Street, where the formal banquet was held. The shop building has a large PTC emblem, which the very next day was removed. At that time, SEPTA was experimenting with paint schemes. This was one of the cars that was backed out of the paint shop so I could take movies of the car. Shop personnel were so accommodating to me at the time that they were still actually painting the car while they backed it out for me to take these movies. You'll note that the masking tape is still on the center door windows. A media event was scheduled a couple of days later, and this scene shows the cars staged for the media to inspect and photograph the vehicles. The media event was canceled, and I am supposedly the only person that ever got movies or footage of that canceled event. SEPTA also tried out a gold and cream paint scheme where they actually had the belt rail painted maroon on one side of the car and blue on the other side of the car to decide which they liked better. You will note now in this scene that the PTC emblem has now been removed from the building. A few months later, SEPTA extensively rebuilt a PCC car with a gold and white paint scheme, and in that rebuild they installed bus turn signals, bus marker lights, aluminum trim inside the car on the wainscoting, extensive remodeling with bus seats with illuminator type fluorescent lighting, and completely rebuilt the traction motors and electrical system of the car. This was on the parking lot upstairs at 200 West Wyoming Avenue, which was the headquarters of SEPTA. The blue, white, and red bus was my favorite, but the reason that it was not selected is because they said it looked too much like a U.S. mail truck, which at the time were painted in that color scheme.
Route 47 ran from a loop at 5th and Godfrey Avenue in North Philadelphia to 8th and Wolf in South Philadelphia. At this point, Route 47 cars are seen both northbound on 7th and southbound on 8th, just south of Girard. The cars pass through the various ethnic neighborhoods along its way. This view shows the car on 8th at Arch, just north of Market Street, with the Route 61 GM diesel bus in the distance. The view was shot from the top of the parking garage. The line had the distinction of crossing itself at various points along its route.
The line also passed the famous Italian market in South Philadelphia, made very famous in the movie Rocky.
The vendors in the 900th block of South 9th Street use the trolley tracks to stake out their stalls. Once the trolleys were taken off, it became a free-for-all, with the vendors' produce blocking traffic. Route 47 was one of the first streetcar lines to be converted to bus operation under SEPTA's banner. Increasing congestion, construction, and bad rail were the reasons given for cutting the line back. The rail had been worn out completely due to the continued use of the streetcar's track brakes, and it would be too costly to replace the track. As a result, the line was cut in half. The portion from 8th and Wolf Streets in South Philadelphia to Spring Garden Street was operated with buses, while the streetcars continued running from Spring Garden Street to 5th and Godfrey in North Philadelphia. At 8th and Green, passengers would transfer from the streetcars to the shuttle buses for their continued trip to South Philadelphia. There was a lineup of buses on Green Street to transport the passengers southbound. The southbound cars were signed for their southern terminus. Any other signage, and the riders would not board the car because they would think it was a cutback car. After making the exchange of riders, Route 47 trolleys would turn onto Spring Garden for the return trip northbound on 7th. At Susquehanna, the northbound cars turned right and crossed the southbound route at 8th. At 7th, the cars turned left and continued north to Dauphin. The cars then turned onto Germantown Avenue and went a short stretch to York. They then turned right on 7th, continuing up to Allegheny. The cars made a right on Allegheny, and the line crossed itself again at 6th, and made a left at 5th on its way to its terminus at Godfrey Loop. At Roosevelt Boulevard, we catch a glimpse of a Route 75 trackless trolley, which shared a short stretch of wire on 5th Street with the Route 47 trolleys.
Reading Railroad crossed Fifth Street, and I was lucky to get this shot of the Reading train overhead with the southbound PCC car on Fifth Street. Fifth Street was a thriving business district. There were also stretches of residential area on Fifth Street. You'll notice the motorman flashed his golden glow headlight on and off.
The loop had passing tracks and was rather large, considering no other trolley lines looped there.
The 8th and Walnut destination sign exposure was a very rarely used cutback.
Jeff Marinoff walked the line from the cutback at Spring Garden to Godfrey Loop, recording on film for posterity Philadelphia's trolleys and the changing Philadelphia neighborhoods.
Route 23 was the longest trolley line in the United States. It operated from Germantown Avenue and Bethlehem Pike all the way to 10th and Bigler down in South Philadelphia. This car is leaving the Bethlehem Pike Loop on the original configuration. The loop was later changed so that the loop was reversed. The car is now approaching the Pennsylvania Railroad Chestnut Hill train station on its southbound journey. The car is going through Chestnut Hill, which even today is a very trendy, fashionable area with antique shops, etc. This is the Mermaid Loop, which was a cutback loop on the 23 line at Germantown and Cresham Valley Drive. Very picturesque area. This car is proceeding southbound on 23, coming out of the Mermaid Loop. And as the car proceeds down Germantown Avenue, it will soon be passing what is the site of the Trolley Car Diner in Philadelphia, which is quite a famous eatery. Much of this rail was rebuilt over the years. The line is still intact today, but it is not operating at the moment. This shows the line crossing Broad Street and Erie Avenue. That was a juncture of the Broad Street subway, the Route 23, the Route 56 trolley, and the Route 53 trolley. There was very, very heavy service at one time on the Route 23 trolley line. Cars every couple of minutes. And I recall when I took these movies back in the 1960s, all you heard on Germantown Avenue were line breakers popping on the cars and trolley gongs clanging. This was the Tioga Street cutback, which was a southbound cutback, which was very infrequently used, and it was generally used so that a southbound car in service would drop its load at the Broad Street subway at Broad and Erie, come down to Tioga Street, cut north, and go back up to Gorgas Lane to the Germantown car barn. And that's what this car in the scene is doing. It's going back to the car barn. When switches were installed at Broad and Erie, and the Germantown car barn was closed, and Luzerne was then used for housing the 23 line, the Tioga Street cutback was redundant, and it was removed. This car is proceeding down 12th Street, and it's now approaching Noble Street, which was a at-grade crossing with the Reading Railroad freight tracks. And it was the location of a very interesting device on the trolley wire due to height restrictions. You couldn't have low trolley wire cross the train tracks, so they had to have a very interesting type of device there to change heights of trolley wire. The trolley is now crossing Market Street on 12th with the Reading Terminal in the background. Here, a diversion was put in place using emergency trackage on Spring Garden Street because of a protest demonstration that went on for about a week in Philadelphia at the time. And SEPTA stationed an employee to guide the trolley pole around the curve because someone had hit a line pole on the corner, knocking the span wires out of alignment and causing the hangers to be out of alignment. So that employee had to stand there while every diverted, detoured Route 23 trolley went from Spring Garden Street to North 7th Street. And this shows the cars on North 7th Street, which once was the Route 47 line that had already been converted to bus. This was not actually part of the Route 23 trolley. It was emergency trackage only. And of course, that trackage no longer exists today. And that shows the Route 47 bus that had replaced trolley service on Route 47. Also, a lot of the congestion and traffic on North 7th Street. Route 50 operated from Rising Sun and Noor all the way down to Oregon Avenue in South Philadelphia via Rising Sun Avenue, Wyoming Avenue, and 5th Street. Originally, Olney Avenue had trolleys that were operated on Route 26, and this was part of a system that once was used for the 26 and the Route 50. Back in those days, Route 50 went to Fox Chase, as did 26. At Rising Sun and Olney, there was a cutback loop on the line. This car is cutting back at Olney, and it's going to head back down to 6th and Oregon in South Philadelphia. It's going to pull out of the Olney Avenue cutback and go southbound on Rising Sun Avenue. Those little brick buildings that you see in the loops were constructed for restroom facilities for the trolley operators. They were not open to the public. Now this car is on Wyoming Avenue, and it will make a left turn to go northbound on Rising Sun Avenue. And you'll notice that the trackless trolley overhead from the Route 75 trackless trolley is evident in this scene. And this car is on Rising Sun making a right turn onto Wyoming Avenue. Again, you'll see the trackless overhead. If you carefully look up above. Route 50 traversed downtown Philadelphia through the Independence Hall area. Here it is at 5th Street crossing Chestnut Street. And of course, this is northbound in the Independence Hall area. What SEPTA did during the bicentennial period in 1976 was take several of the Kansas City, the ex-Kansas City cars, and paint them up for the bicentennial, and each car was painted up for one of the 13 original states. They used the Kansas City cars for that project because the Kansas City cars were used exclusively on Route 50. At the time of the bicentennial, SEPTA borrowed a boat tram from Blackpool, England, and operated it on a tourist loop using Route 50 trackage, southbound on 4th Street and northbound on 5th Street, from 5th and Girard to 4th and Catherine. People loved it. It was one of what were supposed to have been several restored cars, but it didn't happen. Some of the vendors that were selling souvenirs along 5th Street for the bicentennial. Some of the historic buildings in the area of Independence Hall. And on the right of the car, we will soon be passing the Philadelphia Mint. There you see the Philadelphia Mint. And now we're approaching the famous tunnel which took the trolley line and the street under the approach to the Benjamin Franklin Bridge. And this is an interesting scene of the Blackpool boat tram going through the tunnel. And this tunnel was for vehicular traffic as well as trolleys. Automobiles went through that tunnel, and there was a station in the middle of that tunnel. There was a trolley stop with stairs up to the street. And the car, being a two-man car, had to have a motorman and a conductor. The conductor tended to the trolley pole and threw the switches, and the motorman operated the car. SEPTA installed a trackless trolley swivel shoe on the trolley pole of the Blackpool boat tram. And because of that fact, the conductor had to guide the trolley pole through the frog, or switch, in the wire, because the swivel shoe would not take the frog, the conductor having to set the trolley pole over on the other wire manually. The car turns onto Girard Avenue, over to 4th Street, to turn south on 4th Street to return back into town. Car is now on Girard Avenue, and we're now going to take the switch to go southbound on 4th Street. And you'll see the conductor doing his duties of throwing the switches as well as tending to the trolley pole. And here are scenes of regular service cars using ex-Kansas City PCC cars going through the tunnel under the Benjamin Franklin Bridge approaching, crossing 5th and Girard with a service car. Route 56 operated from 23rd and Venango to Tarsdale and Cottman. It's shown crossing Germantown Avenue at Broad and Erie, and that car was one of the major overhauls at the time that had push-type center doors installed in the car. That car is proceeding eastbound. That is a Route 23 car crossing the Route 56 tracks at Broad and Erie. Cars come out of the Luzerne Car Barn at 10th Street to enter service on the Route 56 trolley line on Erie Avenue. This car is at Old York Road in Erie, proceeding eastbound on Erie Avenue. Again, Old York Road in Erie, eastbound on Route 56 on Erie Avenue.
During the latter part of the 20th century, a number of charter groups took the refurbished cars out on a tour of Philadelphia's trolley lines. On this occasion, Jack Doyle from Chicago chartered 2732 and paid a visit to the Cottman Loop. Sweeper C-151 shared snowfighting duties with a number of similar cars during the bad storms in the early 1960s. Richard Vible braved the cold and blowing snow to capture these scenes along the Germantown line. C-151 gets the Mermaid Loop clear for short-term Route 23 service. Gorgas Lane, it clears the track, enabling service to begin the day. Thank you. These cars kept Philadelphia moving before the salting trucks were used. In June 1995, SEPTA introduced the Welcome Line trolley service, direct from Center City, from 11th and 12th Streets, via Girard to the zoo. Three PCCs were refurbished and placed in the service, operating weekends until Labor Day. One car was painted in the Philadelphia Suburban livery, one in the green and cream, and one in the 1938 silver and cream livery. In October 1995, a trolley festival was staged celebrating SEPTA's new headquarters at 1234 Market Street. There were trolley tours using the vintage Peter Witt and the Kawasaki LRVs, as well as shop tours of SEPTA facilities. The pageant drew visitors from all over North America and abroad. 1995 was truly the year of celebration for Philadelphia's trolleys. Remember that blue PCC that Jeff Marinoff filmed that SEPTA was considering as a new livery? That was car 2733. It was refurbished and moved to the SEPTA Transit Museum at 1234 Market Street, where it is currently on public display.
Oh, God.